symbol of Jesus Christ out of people into the world today, recognize Jesus Christ, Lord, and his ultimate sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. church in Jesus' name. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord. Isn't it great to have our worship team worshiping with me? For those that perhaps you're on our team, you can say that they won't keep your social distancing. They stand in the same house, come in and share the same bed. So I think that's why. It's good to be in God's house. And I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 6, please. Matthew chapter 6. We continue on our series, the Lord's Prayer. And we'll be breaking bread. We're going to pass down God's word really challenging. We started with a fallout right. Our Father, who art in heaven. Was the uncle spoke on? The value of God. And all of these subjects, which is phenomenal, we can actually do a whole series on all of it, to be honest. And to be just recognizing the value of God and the significance of it, with significance on who God is in our lives, and who God can be, and what God can do in our lives. And so, I'm going to be talking on Zion. Just like the promise you can seriously be a series for probably half a year of just debate on the kingdom. You can look at the kingdom, you can look at kingdom principles, you can look at what is the kingdom, where is the kingdom, has the kingdom come, has it not, have we gone to the kingdom? But today we're just going to touch the first system by way of an introduction about the high kingdom come. And so we just open a little bit of prayer. Father, we do pray your guidance. Father, we pray your love. Knows the things you need of before you ask him. In this manner, let us all pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one, for yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And amen. The high kingdom come. And so, this morning we're going to study another example of how sometimes we fail to realize the full extent of what we pray for. I'm sure all of us have prayed the Lord's Prayer numerous times. And so, our title this morning is The High Kingdom Come. And next week, Pastor Jeff is going to talk about Thou Will Be Done. Another big subject. Now, to even begin to understand this, because we obviously have to know what kind of kingdom. Because, you know, I've got my own kingdom, I've got your own kingdom. What is that? It's the kingdom of the flesh, the kingdom of what you decide, you're the king of, right? I always tell my family, I'm the king of myself. My children are like, well taught, they always tell me, oh, Jesus. I actually do that as a test. Sometimes they fail. And mostly they're quick to tell me, right? Mostly they're quick to tell me, listen, you're not, which is true, isn't it? But so often, we struggle with our own kingdom. We make our little kingdoms. But what kind of kingdom is Jesus talking about? When we pray for our kingdom come, what are we really asking for? In the Gospel of Matthew, we find the phrase Kingdom of Heaven. And we find it in the first time in the New Testament. Matthew 3, 1 and 2. And it's talking about the person of John the Baptist. And it reads as follows. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent, for the Kingdom of Heaven is at hand. And many times we read this and back of our minds, we sometimes think that John is talking about maybe perhaps the bad judgment, right? But he's not chasing. still, it's been a long time since words were first put out, and we've not seen Jesus in the clouds of glory yet, have we? Since we've heard that word, has anyone seen Jesus coming back now? It's been a long time, it's been over 2,000 years. No, John wasn't talking about the day of judgment or the end of the world. So that leaves us with a question. What was he talking about? What exactly did he mean when he said kingdom of heaven is heaven? Well, to answer this, we need to do a little research. You see, it wasn't very long after John began proclaiming the soon coming kingdom of heaven that Jesus was baptized and he began his ministry. In chapter 4, verse 17 of Matthew, Jesus himself proclaims here the same message. He says this: from this time, Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, when we hear the kingdom of heaven, we automatically think of a place that we will go to when Jesus comes back for us, don't we? We think about the kingdom of heaven. But it's interesting to note that what is really meant by this place is the kingdom of God. Now, know what you think. That's what's meant by the fact. Well, you remember, we started with the Father, and we spoke, and I got it wrong. Just like they would say the fear of heaven. So the fear of heaven instead of the fear of God. The name of heaven instead of the name of God. It's not that unusual actually when you think about it. How many times have you heard people say for heaven is that? Or my heaven. So again, both John, and Jesus himself are really saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Along with the incarnation of Jesus, what's the incarnation of Jesus? When Jesus became man, when Jesus came down and became man, along with the incarnation of Jesus came also the kingdom of God to earth. And Jesus says that he's the king of this kingdom. John 18, verse 37. Pilate therefore said to him, are you the king then? And Jesus answers, you must be saying that I am. For this cause I was born, he said. So when we pray, thy kingdom come, we're actually accepting the offer that Jesus makes to us in Revelation 3:20. Where he says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. Anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him, and he with me. You see, from the time that Jesus was baptized until he ascended and until he rose into heaven, there were many who thought that since he was proclaiming things of that deed, he was proclaiming things of that he was going to take over the Romans, that he was going to take the Romans by force. And when it didn't happen, they were very disappointed. And some no longer believed that Jesus was the king of anything. They left him in droves. Let's take a look at what's recorded in the Gospel of Luke. Luke 17, 20, and 21. No, when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and he said this, that's Jesus speaking. The kingdom of God does not come with observation, nor will they say, see here or see there, for indeed the kingdom of God is within you. Wow, now we're starting to get to some really interesting stuff now, aren't we, church? Sometimes we can become so focused on how good it's going to be when we all get to heaven that we fail to realize that the kingdom of God starts here with us. So, these church, if you have this wonderful kingdom, if you understand that and you know that you are the kingdom of God in you, then it doesn't matter about what your circumstances are, it doesn't matter about the coronavirus. It doesn't matter about South Africa or Southern Africa or America or wherever you are, wherever your place is in this world, where God is based, it doesn't matter what the conditions are of the country. It actually doesn't matter about what your conditions are. I know that's easy to say, Pastor, but I've got you. But that's the truth. Why? Because you are the kingdom of God in you. See, as soon as I say that, don't you want to just put that behind your mask? I am the kingdom of God in you. So when we pray, our kingdom come. We're answering the door that Jesus is knocking. We're not talking to him through a little crack. You know, if you guys think that we put that little crack on us, that even helps, right? But just a little crack with a safety bolt locked on it, which is speaking to Jesus. We've slung the door wide open, and we've invited him in. And recently I read, sermon psychological illustrations. I read this modern day poem. It was just striking to me. It was about a wealthy young man that lived in an immaculate house with a winding staircase and crystal chandeliers and red paintings. When he looked, it was just phenomenal. This house was fit for a king. Anyway, one day he's still a decides to invite the Lord to his beautiful home. And let him stay there. So when the Lord arrived, the young man picked his sports in one of the winding staircases to the room at the end of the room. He opens the door with him. And this is the best room of my own father. It was the best room of father of his house. Getting late, but the young man began to thank Jesus for blessing himself with his presence. He said goodbye to the Lord. As he closed the door, he reminded the Lord that this room was his. He could do anything he wanted. He closed the door and downstairs to his bedroom, drifted off to sleep. He didn't sleep long though, because he was awake in the middle of the night. He rushed to the door and opened it to find a demon there that desperately wanted him to the house. The man fought the demon for all he was worth, just knowing that Jesus would get in the struggle and he would not have any minute soon to go and save him. But Jesus didn't go. And the man was up most of the still fine night fighting this demon until he finally was able to shut the door on the demon. But obviously, they say the next morning that man was exhausted. And saw from his struggle with the intruder. And he wondered why the world Jesus didn't come to his rescue. He thought surely Jesus must have been tired and slept especially well in that last big soft bed that he'd given me. Maybe he just didn't have a call. So that night, he went to bed very early again, hoping to make up for his lost sleep. He'd only been in there a few minutes when there was another knock on the door. As he went in on this time, who was there? Not one, but two demons. The man again struggled and fought all night trying to get the demons out of his house. He battled until a break of dawn, until finally the door was once more closed. He again wondered to himself, why didn't Jesus come to our rescue? After all, I've given him the best room in the house. He could no longer stand exhausted. He came up the stairs to Jesus' room and he knocked on the door. And Jesus opened the door and he said, Lord, if you love me, I find you here to stay with me. I've given the best room in the house. But if you're not even here, you're going to live. Okay, Lord, you can live here. The next room. Let's get out of this room. We have certain things in our lives that we know are wrong. That we know are uncomfortable. But we lock the doors to those who have done it. So that no one, not even Jesus, can have access to. Scripture that complements John 3:3 is Matthew 18:3. Assuredly, Jesus says, I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of God. That's kind of dependent on little children. Anyone who's had a child understands that a little child is not fully independent. They're dependent on all of you and all of the things generally for their parents. When we become Christians, we need to learn how to look to the Lord. We need to look to the Lord. The King of Kings for all of our needs. In Matthew 6:33, Jesus says this about the importance of the kingdom of God. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Thank you. tells you it was the will of Christ to be with us, and you may not have gotten all of it, but Christ has told me you can be a Christian, that's great. But are you really asking God for advice in which way to go? Or are you asking God to help you out of the situation that you took because He was locked in the one room? See, that's the thing when we pray, the Holy Kingdom come. We'll pray the Holy Kingdom with everything. And I know it's not easy. I've got that. But if I'm just going to give up on that and decide, well, that's it. I'll just live my life and I'll view God as my crux, what we need. Putting Him in a room. And probably not even the best room. It's probably a dog that I'll be locking up and say, no, I'm not Jesus. But the question is, we turn around, why is the kingdom come? Why is the King of Kings, the King of the Kingdom, know you?